Campbell, contributing to free software, X.org, Mesa. Yeah, in terms of contributing, but not about like your graphics driver has a bug or something. There's plenty of developers around here that will help you afterwards. This will also be broadcast on the internet later to hopefully invite more people to contribute to Mesa, the Linux kernel, X.org, etc. The panel members here include Keith Packard, Peter Hutter, Martin Perez, Corbin Simpson, Matt Dew, and Kenneth Grandu. Most of them are student developers that have since been hired by a major company or they're still active at university. Keith Packard has been one of the longest contributors to X.org. He was one of the founding members, and he's been going back with X386 now for how many years?
I started working on the X with the system in 1986. When were you born?
So each of the panel members just want to say a sentence or two about how they got started or well, I'm founder of Phronix and Phronix Test Suite.
I wrote a couple drivers a couple of years ago because I didn't like FGRX. It's a love-hate story.
And you work for Google Summer Code?
Yeah, I've done Google Summer Code for 3 years now. 1 year as a student, 2 years as an intern.
I had a project to work on, and turns out the only way I could implement that functionality was a Nuke server. So I went on and did it, and a couple of years later, I read up on me to do the same thing, but this time with a paycheck.
Awesome. And that was at uni, right?
Yeah, so I did it at, the project was while I was at uni, and I once graduated, read up on me to work. So.
Well, I'm still a student, started a PhD soon. I started working on Nuvo because I didn't like the proprietary driver, as simple as that. Same as Corbin. That's it. Like, I'm tired of not being able to find out anything about how X works and stuff. You've been writing all the documentation, it's been great.
Yeah, one of the important things to note is that all contributions to free software projects aren't about just coding, but there's people working on documentation, website maintenance, etc.
I got my job because I was working on the Unix kernel at college, and a friend of mine was working at university in industry at the time, saw the coding that I was doing on the kernel and invited me to start working at Tektronix instead. And so I joined Tektronix in 1983 and started working at X a couple years later when we needed a Windows system for a project. So I too started hacking free software in university. It wasn't called free software at the time, because it's before the GPO.
What was it still called? University?
I didn't go to university, I went to a college. It wasn't big enough to be university.
It was a century.
I was a student at Portland State University the last few years, and got started working on an open source 3D online role-playing game, and we kept having driver bugs. I decided, hey, this is open source, I should be able to help with this, right? And got hopelessly lost a few times, realized a bunch of people were in town, brought them the laptop, like, here, see, it's broken. It used to work, now it's broken. Helped track them down, and got started fixing things, and it's been fun.
And then you sadly got hired.
So basically contributing to X.org and Mesa can be a pain in the ass. Simply because of the complexity of modern graphics processors and other issues like that. Some people have referred to it as working for a petting zoo for crocodiles or wireless bungee jumping from Zach Grusin. So you already explained yourself, but how else did some of the other developers here get started with free software graphics driver development?
I got started with free software when I needed to have a compiler and a debugger for my new processor. And I started contributing to GDB and GCC with the National Semiconductor 32032 processor. Learned that Richard Stallman and the other GNU people at MIT, and started contributing there. And had had been in the state at the same time working on X, which wasn't quite free software at the time. But it's kind of interesting that free software's been around a long time, and it's still a really good way to get an introduction to programming and introduction into corporations that are using free software. So it's a very easy transition. As an employer, I've done a lot of hiring free software developers. And the nicest thing about hiring free software developers is I don't need your resume. Because if I can't find your name through Google, then you probably haven't contributed significantly to free software. And if I can find your name, I can find your code. And there's nothing more important than being able to read code and actual email content from developers working in projects. The most useful information in finding out who you want to hire for your project. You can hire people who have already been working on this project, or if somebody comes up and says, I'd like a job, I haven't worked in this before, I can find their name and find their code and find their email history on the net and go see how they interact with other people, what their coding style is. It's a fabulous way to build online resume in a very useful way. It's great for employers because we don't have to trust what you write in your resume. We can go see what you did. So if you do put down in your resume that you contributed extensively to open source and I don't find you out there, sometimes it happens too. Oh yeah, major contributions to the Mesa project. No record in commit log.
So, hard way of using an alias.
What?
Using an alias.
Oh yeah, don't do that. Yeah. Nobody wants your. Some people do contribute free software with a pseudonyms. Usually those are people who work for large corporations who don't want them to be contributing open free software. That used to happen a lot more than it does these days. I don't know too many corporations that forbid their employees from working on their spare time with free software. Well, maybe Jay.
Not Microsoft.
Obviously, you can't work on something that's directly related to what you do in the office if you're working on proprietary software.
Yeah. How many developers are there now in OTC?
I don't know how big OTC is. Our group has, you know, several handfuls of developers working on Linux graphics right now. So, you know, we keep hiring more. So.
Anyone else have anything to add about this?
So I'm a awesome writer as well. So pretty much for any developer position, sometimes we even get a request in of people just looking for a job. And if you don't have a job opening, you have to match your resume because they've contributed publicly. That does help a lot. And yeah, we've had some interesting applicants where apply for a post job and read their online resume and what contributions they've done, and suddenly they realize they're not quite fitting for that job, but we might have a job for them somewhere else. So
you had a grocery store stock clerk apply for a position, didn't you?
Yes.
Happened to be contributing to free software for years and years extensively.
Seems to have worked quite well.
Yeah.
What about staying involved either after like the bugs for your games that you've experienced have been fixed? What made you stay involved with free software and the same for the rest of you after your first like milestone has been accomplished?
There's just a lot of really interesting work going on. I love free software. People might say I'm a bit of an idealist, but it's the only thing I use, and I'd really love to see things in the future just take off on it, like a particular gaming. There's not a lot of gaming on Linux right now, and partly that's because we support OpenGL 2, and they just released OpenGL 4. And so we've got a lot of catching up to do. It's a really great thing to work on. I've been interested in for a while in compilers, and one of the projects that we had doing was that in modern graphics, it's all about shaders, these little programs that you write and you have to compile to run on your GPU. So, having studied compilers and languages like the in school, the big thing moving forward was compilers, and we didn't have an easy one. And so I wanted to get involved with that and start working on the new one and just hopefully improve Linux graphics.
Like I said, when I started hacking Mesa, it was completely for ideological reasons. I had the motive. I had hardware that had buggy binary drivers, but it was also AMD hardware, and AMD has just published too could do something, even though my my C was very weak. I didn't know anything about compilers. I was basically jumping into something that was a very arduous task, and I had a lot of learning to do before I could be efficient at it. I think I spent maybe 4 months asking stupid questions and experimenting and learning C and reading code before I actually wrote anything useful.
You remember that? Yeah. Yeah. You remember all the stupid questions I asked? There were a lot of them. There's still a lot.
But you only asked dumb questions for 4 months.
It's a year and a half, and I'm still asking. He only realized that he was asking. He only knew.
There's the illusion questions for 4 months. There's the illusion that to contribute to a project, you actually need to know everything.
Could somebody reach over there and silence that phone? I know it's mine.
If you pour beer on it, you can.
Well, the nice thing about having a history of contributing useful stuff is that we
break something, you forgive yourself a little faster.
But then no one else lets you forgive.
Oh, no.
Never. It depends on the nature of the break.
That's what the gathering is like.
That's right. And of course, there are some projects where even project founders who have hacked on the project for a decade and a half know the code inside and out may not commit directly. They have to go through the review process. I can think of a couple of projects I've worked on where it doesn't matter if you have 1 week or 10 years of experience, you may not commit directly. And then there are projects that are run the exact opposite way, where nearly anyone can drive by patch and it'll get accepted with minimal review. So it depends on the community. We try and run our communities in a pretty friendly, nice, non-biting newbies way. I think we do a pretty good job of that.
Yeah. And there are different cultures in different projects. Like the Linux kernel has a fairly good reputation, fairly bad reputation for being hostile to new developers. I don't know if you've watched the Linux kernel manifest or heard about the Linux kernel manifest and the flame wars that erupt when somebody proposes something completely insane.
That's from the top.
Yes.
But that's not a bad thing. I mean,
it's not necessarily a bad thing, but it is very confrontational.
Yeah. What I wanted to do was, when I started working on Nubo, was to understand what really was inside the kernel. Before I was working on the Windows kernel, and I really hated that. The documentation just sucked. And you couldn't just... The only thing I could do was reverse engineering. So it was not... It was stupid. I just wanted to learn how to make an operating system. So I went to Linux. And yeah, Nubo seemed a good place because they only contribute from computers. Also, I'm saying, add the documentation of the kernel and the fact that you want to try to add new features, it forces you to learn how everything around it works, so you get more knowledge, and when you're trying to push patches, you get reviewed, re-reviewed, and you get, as has been said, pointers to what's wrong, and that's really a nice way to learn. I mean, there is some code I've been trying to push for 6 months, maybe more. I rewrote it like 8 times, maybe more, but it's great to learn. You know, learn a lot.
John, did you have something else to add?
Yeah, Peter mentioned something that, you go in, you accept, you may not understand the whole thing, but you pick a section and you understand that. That's not actually a skill I find you can take for granted. The ability to stop, if there's any challenge I find in any, particularly any big engineering organization, it's people who, if there's any part of it they don't understand, then their sort of threshold for understanding everything else gets lowered too. Like, they can't understand this part if they don't understand that part. And I don't have a good feeling. I think within this group, I imagine everybody's good at that, at picking a piece and learning it and making it clear. Or you sort of don't get in. But I don't have a good feel for how common that is. I don't see it that much outside of, say, open source projects. And it strikes me that being able to make certain pieces clear, like make the first piece clear to somebody, even if it's not make the whole design, just pick one piece and make it clear, that feels like it might help another group of people get in. Or maybe we want to select out and those people wouldn't fit the lead picture anyways, I'm not sure. I think there are skills that core developers take for granted that aren't necessarily common.
And Keith, over all these years, what made you stay around? Like, what keeps you motivated and not being burned out of doing the X and the same things every day?
It's working with people, right? The software, I've been working on the same software essentially for closing out 30 years. But the people keep changing. We don't constantly get new people, but people grow up and you get occasionally new people coming in, and that's a lot of fun. And you get to interact with them in a very technical, deep technical way. And that's been a lot of fun. And of course, the software may look the same, but technologies underneath it are constantly changing. I mean, when we started X in 1986, we had monochrome screens, black and white screens. And that was all we had. And it was amazing that we could get to do anything. All the rasterization for everything was done by the CPU, because that was all you really had. I mean, things have changed so much in how graphics are done. It's just been, you know, we've been able to layer in new technologies into the Windows system, taking advantage of new market capabilities and new user interface paradigms, and it's been a great, great thing to find. So just constant change. Nothing is ever the same.
This is
uphill
quite
twice.
Does anyone have any advice on how they got hired by the company that they ended up working for, or either for employing someone that's been working for open source, aside from what Keith said earlier? And like Peter was, it was a pretty easy process for you. Or?
Well, it was easy once it got rolling. So, but in my case, it was definitely helped that I knew some of the people already inside Red Hat. So, because they then talked to their manager, and I got a job opening. So, when I officially applied, I actually got declined. I said, sorry, but I don't have a job. About a month later, there wasn't a job open suddenly. So, you know, it definitely helps to be in the community, to know people. So, you know.
So, most people in any line of work get their jobs by being recommended by their friends. So, this is a way to make new friends.
Who work at companies?
Who work at companies?
There's like a million open source projects out there that you can work on. Some of them are, you know, in all of them you'll gain a lot of experience and really a lot of skills as a programmer. Some of them are interesting to people who are hiring, and some of them maybe less so. That's one of the reasons I wanted to work on Mesa, is that I saw that there's so much work that needs to be done, and in a room like this a few years ago there were less people. There's not enough people to do all the work. So if you get up to speed doing it, likely you will get a job doing that. And then, as Ian said, usually that works by you do some work, you get to know people, people get to know you, they see your work, and they say, this guy is really good, I want to hire him. Or, you know, you don't have an opening, but they do, you guys should hire him. The beautiful thing about open source is that it's all public, it's all on the internet. So, you know, Ian and I live in the same town, but I never talked to him. I started seeing his posts on the mailing list and started talking with him on there. And got to know him that way. So it's a great way to get to know the people and make those connections.
And it's also great to learn and to interact with people. And because when you're doing open source development, the only thing you can do is send emails or the IRC, and that's pretty much it. It's harder to communicate, so it requires some work on your side to try to make things understandable. It's great. Anyway, it's great for project management. Project management, really great.
Building up on that, I can't recommend choosing the open source project you work on based on the premise that you might get a job a couple of years later. You should choose something that you're actually interested in as well, because working in your free time on a software project just in case you get a job 4 years later than that is probably not going to be the best thing you can do in your life.
Well,
so do something that's interesting for you. It's much more important than hope. That's
something.
You'll
do more work and write better code or something.
Well, and when I'm looking at a potential candidate for a new hire, they don't have to have worked in the project that I'm interested in having them work on. It's important that their work be available for me to review the quality of their engineering. And so if you've worked on something completely, we hired somebody recently who'd never worked in OpenGL before, but had a strong history in doing software analysis and compiler technologies, completely outside of 3D graphics work. Look at the work that he'd done and see what his coding style was, what his engineering talents were, and it was pretty easy to review what he'd done outside of the graphics to know that he'd be a good fit for the team in terms of his technical skills. And it's just a matter of making sure that he's not a big idiot and can enjoy sushi.
like Peter, kind of, would you continue doing what you're doing now if you are hired by Intel or Red Hat?
Absolutely. Just a hugely rewarding thing. Getting your patches into, so I look at it, you know, there's countless people working in the software industry, the that sit in a queue and write software and have their or project get canceled before it ever sees the light of day. And I never wanted to do that. But in with what I do now working at Mesa, even if I wasn't doing that as an AJOC, I get to work on the software that all of you get to run on your laptops, and I get to push it out to you as soon as I have it ready. And you all use it. And that's just immensely cool. It's very, very rewarding.
You've clearly worked in industry before. Maybe not. Maybe you've just seen it on TV.
I think that if you find your if you find yourself enjoying open source software and enjoying contributing, that is its own reward, and it's also a reward to the community that definitely surpasses whether or not you're compensated for it. I think I've written maybe 400 or 500 commits in my day job right now, which is not related to anything in my community repositories. In my community repositories, I have something like 6,000 commits. An order of magnitude work goes into open source, even though I have less time in the day for it. It's good because I enjoy it. You know, and that's independent of compensation. I'm not sure Keith is going to tell me if 6,000 is like a drop in the bucket, right?
Dude,
I don't know how many commits I've done.
Well, one impressive commit that Peter, he's the number one person for the Git history of X server right now.
Yep.
They do his multiplayer actually. Too.
Yeah, those are my positions.
Would any of you have any advice for people that are still in university for what they should like either study the classes or anything along those lines talk about in their free software degree?
Any course that lets you write a ton of code. The only way to learn how to write code is to write code. If you have a course that wants you to write, you know, a 20 or 30,000 line project every semester, that would be awesome. I don't think universities allow the students to do that.
Industry is that you don't have very much depth in school. But you look at things like, you know, how many thousands of hours do you think Michael Jordan spent just practicing shooting free throws?
Exactly.
Thousands of hours. And how much time do software engineers spend writing software while they're in school? Tens?
Yeah.
Hundreds?
Yeah. So that's one of the advantages of doing an open source project is that you're working in open source when you're living is that you can spend a huge amount of time developing a huge amount of code, learning how to write software, which your classes frankly won't teach you. Your classes are going to teach you formal methods of software engineering and a bunch of computer science stuff, which is a useful structure. But in terms of the actual practice of writing code, there's really nothing that beats just sitting down and writing, oh, I want to write a C compiler today. So maybe start typing and you know, have them do the standard IDH and start from there.
Or write code, and also the art of picking up someone else's code base and being productive. That is a completely different set of skills.
Oh, that's a really good point. That's something that
you just never,
you never get in school at all. Because it used to be when I was a child, when you started writing software, you started basically from the machine, right? You had the compiler deck and you had your Fortran program. And your Fortran program was compiled on the compiler deck, and then it ran your program, and that was it. There wasn't any operating system environment, there wasn't any GUI toolkit, there wasn't somebody else's program you were hacking on. And now when we write software, we take pieces from all over the world, bring them together, and glue them together, like when you're writing a web app. Did you write your own SQL database? Probably not. Did you write your own, you know, did you write your own whatever Bobcat's web developers use for infrastructure these days? Take all these pieces. Django or Ruby on Rails or whatever stuff. You bring all these pieces together. And as a software developer, you need to be able to integrate a huge pile of software and understand, at least at some level, this huge wealth of software available to the world to you and bring that all together to use it in your project. Something which I've seen a couple of software projects at the university I'm affiliated with in Portland. Occasionally they'll have students do larger projects involving large pieces of software. That's a really useful skill to be able to have, is to go out and take an existing piece of software and change it in some way or incorporate it into your software in some way and learn how to read software and how to evaluate software.
Can you
if you end up as a full-time software developer, you probably spend more time pitching in other people's code than you have to read than writing your own code.
I hope so.
In many, many cases, that other people's code used to code you've written 3 years ago, but it still it looks like other people's code, so.
I wrote that. What could I possibly have been thinking?
I work for the open source lab, so we hire lots and lots of students while they're still students. I don't know what local curricula are like, but we find that there are really only two courses that really hugely are guaranteed to make people better developers. And one of them is a special topic in open source. So basically, here's open source, here's what open source is. And then another topic that forces people to go through and learn 5 or 6 different languages, including one that they could not have known about prior to taking the course. So people get to learn the joys of Prolog or Ada or Scada.
Ada.
Sorry, I don't know that one yet, but you know.
I'm sure. I had a review an excerpt written in Ada once.
That sounds classic. Anyway, as far as university courses go, those are really the only two that we see are really useful for students that want to get into open source. You know, one course to teach them how to think in different languages and another course to teach them how open source works. Most of the classes you take aren't going to prepare you super well for jumping into open source as much as jumping into open source. Just go for it. Don't worry about whether or not you have the right classes for that.
There are some things that, at least when I was in school, they didn't really have a class to teach you, but that's how to use tools. As an engineer, you use so many tools like your debuggers, build systems, and make files, maybe automate. I've seen a lot of students who have every school project that's like 1 or 2 source files. They'll just type write a make file for that. That's a really useful skill to have. How to run the debugger on it and figure out why is this crashing and step through things. If you haven't heard of it, Valgrind is an incredibly useful tool where, you know, the moment you walk off the end of your array, it will tell you and say, hey, so this is where it went wrong, not this other place later when it crashed. Source code revision tools. Open source is all about source code. A lot of projects these days use Git. Subversion has been popular in the past. It's less of it these days, but a lot of university students end up just sending zip files of their project through email back and forth. And that's a really rough way of working. If you learn Git and more entrepreneurial tools like that, you'll be much better off for it.
Try to find internships, because you learn program by doing it. Leads your program full time, and you get a little bit of pay for it, it's worth it. That's pretty much how I got involved before I started. I did internship at the same university, and there's a lot of embedded stuff. So.
Try to find a group of friends that you can get passionate about it with. Like, it helps to get to the difficult parts if you got something you can bounce ideas off of.
3D graphics in the BASIC project. We recently wrote our GLSL compiler. And if you guys have taken compiler classes in school, in your textbooks, there are optimization algorithms that they talk about that we haven't gotten around to implementing yet. And it's not because they're particularly complicated, it's just that we've been busy. So if you wanted to, you could potentially pick one of those up. And that would be, that's how I actually got started, was working on the compiler, because I knew about that, I didn't know about these graphics card things. And I just started reading patches and figuring out how the compiler connected with the driver, and I started learning about the driver. I got really confident in the compiler and not at all confident in the driver, and started building confidence in the driver.
There's also on the x.org wiki a to-do list, I'm not sure how updated that is, actually, of low, medium, and high-hanging fruit for accomplishing. Keith, do you know if that's updated at all, or?
I haven't been.
Well, in general. Does anyone actually know if that's been updated, the to-do list?
If it's only a year out of date, that's pretty good. It's probably so accurate.
Yeah, it's... There's a lot of data on the two wikis, one for X and one for ERI, and they both could use cleaning up. And the cleanup is pretty easy. You look at information, you check and see whether it's out of date, you update it, you're done. There's a Bugzilla with about 10,000 open bugs. Now, this sounds a little bit crazy, but if we all chip in and just take care of 100 bugs each. More seriously, a lot of these bugs are very old, and you can simply read through and say, oh, this hardware is no longer supported. This bug can be closed. Or we remove this component, or we fix this bug. And this is also a great gateway to that trick I mentioned earlier of asking really stupid questions on IRC in order to bring up bad memories from the people who originally wrote the code and get some more information in the process.
And the usual way of getting into it is that you have something that some particular piece of software either doesn't do right or doesn't do at all that you want it to do. Then you go in and figure out how to fix it.
Well, that usually leads to opening new bugs.
Okay.
I don't know if we're ready to encourage that. opening a new bug and communicating with developers that way about something that you want to fix and that you have a personal stake in can also be really useful. Because that kind of communication often leads to re-examination of code that might not have been.
Yeah, sometimes just if you have a problem with software, filing a bug is a good way to learn about how the software works. Because if you file a bug about a behavior problem, the developer will come back and ask you a bunch of questions. And you'll have to go back and study the program to find out how to answer the question of the developer, potentially run a bunch more tests, and potentially even learn how to bisect the software tree and find out where the bug occurs, and then you'll actually see what part of the code is causing the problem that you're having. And I'll lead you into a small part of the code from where you can kind of start to think more about the system.
There's just something on top of what Keith just said. One thing I found is it's hugely important. If you, you know, if you want to start learning code, look at the commits to it. Look at the commits for that area. And that will tell you, okay, so a change that did this hit these files, did these kind of things. And you know, we were talking a bit earlier about the need to pick one place to learn it. And I thought that's a great place to just sort of kind of
you can see what recent activity has been. You can see where people have been working.
Right, like you can monitor the RSS feed to see, hey, there's a change to R600G, these were the files, and this is what this gets you introduced, or this is how you corrected bug number or whatever. But simply for monitoring the RSS is very useful as well.
Yeah, one of the best things I find is just, if there's a project you're interested, go sign up for their mailing list and just start reading it. So I did that with the Intel graphics list and the Mesa dev list, and I didn't understand half of the stuff that was going on, but it at least began to let me get familiarized with the terminology. So I don't know what a GTK mapping is, but I hear people talking about it, and it's generally in this part of the code seems to have something to do with memory. And things like that. And then you get to pick up the lingo and the acronyms, and you get to see who the people are in the community, who's doing what sort of things. And so you might decide, oh, this person seems to do stuff in this area, and maybe I should talk to them about something.
Okay. There's something you can do. You can use the current development version of the software you would like to contribute to. First, your spot bugs. That's, yeah, has to. Then also you can check every feature every time it's added. So as you said, you can just have a look at the commits and try to understand if there's something that is of interest to you. You can just look at the code starting from the line that's been changed, and that's really what I did at first, and it's great. Great.
Do the students now have any other questions about contributing free software or open source development in general?
I have a question. For you, what's your name?
My name's Keith.
Keith, okay. So you're talking about as an employer, you like to go look at what people have actually gotten open source, right? So my question is, do you just look at the quality of their code, or do you also look at the languages they use? Like if you're looking for somebody to hire that knows C++.
I don't care what language is programming.
So you're just looking for quality on that, and you figure the language will come. Okay.
You know, stuff that you can learn easily, like a programming language, that really not important to me. If you've written a ton of really great code in Lisp, great. It's not just the quality of the code, it's the quality and structure, the ability to code, the accuracy of the comments. If there's a commit history, I look at the commit history and see whether the changes you're making are well isolated, well documented. Commit logs, yeah. Having a Git history of about a year or two longer for somebody, that tells you more about them than any amount of energy you have to do.
John, did you have anything else to add since you've been hiring for AB?
No, I think just one comment I was going to make is, with my job, I manage people working on proprietary, you know, the proprietary side and the open source side. The one pattern I've seen is that if you've gone through and learned the things you need to work well in the open source community, you fit in anywhere in the company. You've got the skills you need, you know.
Yeah, except you're hostile to the people doing closed source software. They're naturally hostile to anybody doing closed source software.
Yes, exactly. And then starts the relationship off right.
On the right foot.
But, no, there's a...
You guys are doing it wrong.
Yeah. But the good thing is frequently they are.
Well, the frustrating thing about a lot of universities these days is that they insist that the students do a lot of work for the university, and those projects are very rarely open source.
Yep.
And so it's often the case that your own university stuff is owned by the university, it's not open source. And so one of the nice things that I like to have encourage students to do is to publish all of their code with a GPL license if the professor hasn't told them otherwise. Just gives the professor a little legal lesson. No, you can't not publish my code. Here's the license.
And just to add on that too, you know, when we're hiring too, when you're looking at code, you're looking for, you know, an eye toward the they structured their structs this way, and it, that's a logical way to do it, not this other way that would have been maybe easier, but yeah, there's some thought going on to the way that they've done that sort of thing.
Well, I'm going to be mailing those posts. So, any mailing list post you've ever made, your employer will be needed. That's related to source code and related to things you don't want us to know about.
Assuming you're not under some crazy sort of them.
Yeah, we find those too.
So one thing that ends up being a major shock for a lot of people who come from closed social sources is that, oh god, everyone in the world is going to see my code. I better make it actually good. I can't be lazy and just put some rubbish in that works. It has to actually be good. That's hard for a lot of people.
You missed my post.
Huh?
You missed my post.
Maybe.
And being honest feedback as well. I fairly regularly send them patches and data sets and other shit to it another way. And you know, it might be a bit much, but yeah.
He only tells you that.
you do sort of have to be prepared for some fairly straightforward criticism. Just don't take it personally. Or, you know, don't think, oh, you know, I can't believe someone on a public list said that this was really bad. Like, it's not actually true at all. So just, you know, if that happens, just shrug your shoulders and just keep on going.
Actually, on that note, I'd say if someone actually comments and critiques your code, I'd say take those compliment because it means they felt it was worthwhile enough to actually look at your code. So if you get no replies to your posts at all, be worried. If you get 30 replies saying, fix this, that means you have 30 people who felt your code was actually worth looking at. And then so, the people who, that means that they actually want to see that change, but just not the current form, but they do want to see that change in my opinion. And there's 30 people who will remember your name. So, well, if you do it more and more people. So. And finally, except for a couple really, really leads projects, none of which XORG is not like you, for the most part, if you make a tiny mistake, and I mean, you know, like, oh no, you used int instead of unsigned, or you probably could have done this with a slightly better algorithm, didn't you pay attention in your CS400 class? That doesn't happen in most projects. Because most people are not writing perfect code with every single line, every single commit, every single div.
I mean.
But my point is, don't be too worried about whether or not people are going to unfairly judge your code. You know, we're all people here. We all write code. We all understand that a lot of times you can't think of every single thing. Most of us can't think of every single thing when we're writing our code, and that's part of what a review process is for. So you know, don't be embarrassed to give it a try and make an attempt and publicly say, here, this is what I came up with.
When also there is a mode to win open source, it's released early, released often, so as people can check what you've done, get contributors, or at least comments, and this is good. Because keeping things private doesn't help.
And if you fix a bug the wrong way, it doesn't matter. You've done 90% of the work isolating where the bug is. Right? Figuring out what's broken is the hardest part of fixing a bug. Fixing it wrong, we can fix the fix. But finding out where the bug is in the code, that's the hard part.
Any other questions from the students?
I got one. So ACM is looking at, you know, actually starting some real projects. They're not going to be big, but you know, they're going to be open source projects. And I'm going to be leading one of those. And I was curious how. So some tips on leading a project, directing a group of people in an open source project, like some basic things that you need to do, I guess.
Keith,
Depending on how many people are involved in the project, you need to each adopt a particular role or particular area of the project, not necessarily for doing the development of that area, but for maintaining control of the code in that area and doing the final review together. We ran the next project for a number of years as kind of a free-for-all, where everybody was allowed to put changes in wherever they liked. And it led to fairly rapid development, but it also led to a lot of bugs and a lot of unreviewed code. And about 3 years ago, we changed the model where we had a more structured approach, where Peter's in charge of input, and Daniel's in charge of XKB2. And
I see you're very happy.
One day.
Yeah, it's okay.
GPU comes out now, so it's
yeah. Time. In any case, we have people who are assigned to kind of watch over a particular area and manage the changes in that area. Not to produce all of those changes, but to kind of shepherd them through and get them merged into the final product. And I think that's helped us a lot in making sure that people are checking processes and conformance of processes, like we require that all patches be reviewed before they get merged. And just having somebody whose job it is not to do the review, but to say, oh, this patch hasn't seen sufficient review, it's not going to be other things about project management. We don't do very good project management these days. In just regular corporate project management, one of the most important things we do is build a schedule upfront, fat-thumbing estimates for every small task to tasks that are no longer than a week long. And if you're doing a project that's only 3 or 4 months long, I might cut that down to a couple of days in length. And then tracking your schedule as you're doing a project, making sure that items are getting completed when they're supposed to get completed. Because the best thing you can do is discover that you're behind schedule, way ahead of what you actually have to have the deliverables due. Because that means you may have done the design wrong, you may have done the project factorization wrong, somebody may be overcommitted, somebody undercommitted, but you can recover your schedule better the earlier you find that out. So the more finer grade you're willing to make the schedule up front, the better you can track it, but there's obviously some limited term of what you're going to get in return, how much return you get.
We actually have an example of that.
Yeah.
We have a way to pull up on there.
Yeah. Which page are you looking
at? DRIdesktop.org/wiki/workcube.
Oh, yeah. Because actually on the previous page as well for...
Yeah, we just manage our schedule in a wiki. And so we have a bunch of tasks, and the task list was something we worked on collaboratively to generate what the tasks were, but we did not immediately assign people to every single task. A bunch of tasks have people assigned, but a bunch of them don't. And the nice thing about that is that if you feel confident in a particular area and you're not working on anything today, you can go find a task to do, put your name on it, and say, I'll be working on this. And then at the end of the week, the project manager will come along and say, hey, you've been working on this. What'd you get done? And they could say, well, you know, I got kind of started, then I got kind of stuck. And that happens a lot. And making sure that somebody assigned to actually checking progress and making sure that nobody gets stuck. Okay. That's way too easy. That happens way too often in software. You'll try to do a whole bunch of work, and it's like, I don't understand. I don't know how to do this. I'm stuck. And if you're stuck for 3 days, that's 3 days of lost work. You probably can recover your schedule from that. If you're stuck for 6 months, like may have happened with one project I ran, it's really hard to recover those 6 months, and then your graphics driver support for recent chips that may be delayed.
Depending on how adventurous you are, you might want to try instilling your ACM students with a sense of wonder and fulfillment about common software practices now. You know, things like using a DBCS, Git or Mercurial or Bazaar, writing documentation, writing tests, explaining to other people exactly what you intended by commenting your code with even a 5% comment rate.
And during early design, doing things like pair programming.
Anything that...
Right.
There's
all kinds of wacky programming paradigms you can try.
Well, yeah, but there's some paradigms like documentation that have been tested, tried, and true.
What project do you know that has documentation?
Right now, I probably test 2 dozen pages of documentation and a 30% comment rate. But, you know, I'm weird, so.
Yep. But you know, like if you teach kids how to do this now, because there aren't any classes for this, you know, even OSU where I work has the amazingly progressive half a term of testing and documentation. It's amazing, you know, but kids forget all of it, you know. So running a project, not just in an open manner, but also with an eye towards good practices can really help them get a head start.
Design for test.
Ian, what was the testing stuff set?
Take this huge goal and break it down into little tasks you can understand and track. trying to get an idea of how many tasks there are and whether your schedule is attainable or not. We've been fat thumbing GL3O by the end of the year for 18 months or so. You know, we thought it was feasible, but it wasn't until we actually did this scheduling exercise that we discovered, oh wait, this could actually happen.
So. Well, then that also helps you identify what the things, what the dependency chains are that could totally screw everything up. And so you can be sure, we better have someone start working on this big, long arc, like, you know, now.
Yeah.
Like, leave this meeting and we'll start
just
working.
Basic project planning, right? And starting out with project planning, starting out with an initial design and initial design review, and then doing some initial project planning. Of course, software never stays the same. OpenGL 3 is a rare exception to the rule because the requirements aren't going to change because some bozo board put together the spec for OpenGL like a decade ago. No,
yeah. I guess, yeah, probably the most important part is the breaking it down bit. Like, it's pretty easy to, if you're starting on something fresh, it's pretty easy to sit there and sort of spend ages, like, you know, make the website, have the logo contest, get a mailing list going, like, get this sort of amazing structure together that the whole thing will hang around. But then when it comes down to it, it's the middle where all the code should be, you've got absolutely nothing. Which is to say, don't write documentation and don't try and get other people involved and stuff. But ultimately, if you sort of built everything around it, but you haven't got the actual code there, then what are you going to do there?
Well, note that a bunch of these tasks are not coding. A bunch of these are tests. Right? So you put your test development right into your development schedule because we have to have tests to know if what you're writing is correct.
Speaking of tests, what's your position on TDD or test-driven development?
Test-driven development. We do a bunch of that these days. If you have a good spec and you can write good tests, that's easy. If you have a well-defined project like GLSL 1.30, it's really easy to write tests for that. If your specification for your project is write a web app, a web store for selling turtles, it's a lot harder to write tests for that environment. So unless you have a pre-existing specification that you're coding to, I find the specification so much more important to produce than anything else. You need to start by writing a specification. The problem is, unless your project is well specified,